Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents I Lost My Girlish Laughter by Jane Allen, narrated by Amy Rubinate. Introduction. In early 1937, when film producer David O. Selznick was putting the finishing touches on his classic Hollywood Cinderella story, A Star is Born, his former secretary was writing her own version of the film business. The result, I Lost My Girlish Laughter, is the most important Hollywood novel that most people have never read. Though Selznick's place in popular memory has endured, thanks to the continued popularity and notoriety of his production, Gone with the Wind, 1939, Silvia Schulman is a footnote in Hollywood history, even among mavens and cinephiles. But without Schulman, Selznick arguably would not have bought Margaret Mitchell's novel, Gone with the Wind, or acquired his respectable reputation as an innovative producer of women's pictures. In 1936, Schulman read Mitchell's Hefty Galleys, and, along with her friend and colleague, Selznick's New York-based story editor, Kay Brown, badgered the producer to purchase the screen rights for $50,000. Schulman had worked in the film business since the early 1930s, when she left Hunter College for RKO Pictures. She later joined Selznick's MGM production team as his personal secretary and moved with him when he formed his own company in 1935. Schulman was one of thousands of women who worked for the American film industry in the 1930s. Industry leaders and journalists of the time claimed women made up nearly half of all studio employees and argued that Hollywood was one of the few places where women could earn as much money as men. Actresses such as Carol Lombard, Constance Bennett, and Katharine Hepburn netted salaries higher than President Roosevelt. The public fascination with the lives of Hollywood stars dominated the pages of fan magazines such as Photoplay and Modern Screen, fueling a popular literary and film genre focused on the highs and lows of making it in Hollywood. Most of these stories, perhaps predictably, were about the lives and loves of stars, not secretaries like Miss Schulman, nor the legions of female writers, directors, editors, designers, researchers, agents, journalists, and producers who made their living at the studios. In Selznick's A Star is Born, for example, filmstruck aspiring actress Esther Blodgett, Janet Gaynor, heads west to Hollywood, and with the help of a glamorous, self-destructive legend, Frederick March, and a paternal producer, Adolph Menju, transforms into star sensation Vicki Lester. Selznick saw a lot of himself in fictional producer Oliver Niles, the Hollywood grandee who shepherds the starlet to fame. Played by Menju, Niles was considerate and discreet, a man of impeccable taste, certainly not the Hollywood mogul hashtag MeToo advocates love to hate these days. Oliver Niles would never be caught pinching any secretaries behind. Selznick did care about helping women's careers. His production What Price Hollywood, 1932, was part tribute to silent star Clara Bow's struggles with fame. He gave Janet Gaynor a job when 20th Century Fox chief Daryl F. Zanuck fired her for growing out of her girlish screen image. He worked with female screenwriters including Jane Murfin, Sarah Y. Mason, and Wanda Tuchok, and he launched Hepburn's career. But Silvia Schulman had a different perspective on her boss. Selznick may have liked working with women, but not always in the best way. His clumsy romantic passes, pats, and lunges at female employees were a normal part of the workday in his organization. Early on in her job, Schulman had dodged his wandering hands, but she subsequently managed to maintain a respectful working relationship with her boss. Other colleagues willingly said yes to Mr. Selznick. Like many secretaries, Schulman had a sharp gift for satire, honed over many hectic years in the business. She knew where all the bodies were buried, or bedded. But rather unusually, she was also a gifted writer. In 1935, she and friend Barbara Keon co-wrote a play with the cheeky, polygamous title, Adam Had Three Eves. Although her boss liked it enough to buy it, Selznick never went forward with the film version. Schulman was not promoted to screenwriter. Instead, the producer kept her busy with dictation and reading serious potential properties for production by real writers. Schulman may have fumed, but she wasn't one to waste time. If Adam Had Three Eves was just going to be shelved while Selznick took credit for her production advice, Schulman would get even by secretly writing her version of the great American novel. She certainly had enough material, but not much time. As she joked to her friend, the columnist Sheila Graham, she was so enamored of her job as confidential secretary that she worked sometimes as late as 5 o'clock a.m. Schulman confided in her boyfriend, publicist and screenwriter hopeful Ring Lardner Jr., but it wasn't until they married and went on their honeymoon in early 1937 that she had time to put everything on paper. The family story goes that they spent their honeymoon in some Laguna Beach hotel, writing. He worked on a script, she wrote a novel. At this point, Schulman's former writing partner was too busy to collaborate on a novel. Keon was managing Selznick's stable of male writers in their numerous failed attempts to script Gone with the Wind. So Schulman asked another woman with a grudge against the system, Jane Shore, to help shape and polish the manuscript. Shore had come to Hollywood from New York back in 1928, wrote Broadway Sally for star Nancy Carroll, and had to watch Fox executives shelve the picture when too many Broadway and Sally-themed films glutted the new sound era market. In addition to Sally's Shoulders, 1928, Beau Broadway, 1928, and The Broadway Melody, 1929, Warner Brothers released Sally, 1929, an adaptation of the classic stage hit starring Marilyn Miller, the original Broadway Sally. Shore had been out of steady work ever since and had tried joining the new Screenwriters Guild in 1935 in a last-ditch effort to get some decent assignments. The opportunity to help Schulman write a gossipy takedown of Hollywood and then to sell it for a killing to the very people they were satirizing was too good to pass up. At night, down at the Lardner-Schulman abode, she helped organize the sequence of stories, gags, and nightmares Schulman had collected from years of working at the top of the picture business. In a rebuttal of her boss's current rags-to-riches star romance, Schulman gave the secretary's view of the film business in I Lost My Girlish Laughter. Like Schulman, protagonist Madge Lawrence is a native New Yorker, an ex-college girl on the lookout for a decent-paying job in Hollywood. When a letter of introduction from her newspaper contacts does not open any studio gates, she heads out one evening, depressed and dateless, for a consoling drink or two. It's then that she meets a genial director, likely modeled on Selznick's employee John Cromwell, who, impressed with her college education and the fact she's not just another bleach blonde on the make, gets her a job as producer Sidney Brand's secretary. The legendary Brand is, of course, Selznick, who was known for putting his personal brand on every aspect of his productions, often to the chagrin of his staff. But readers soon discover that, rather than being one of the young geniuses of the system, Brand is the comic villain of Madge's story. He's a bumbling, narcissistic hypochondriac with a flabby mouth and wide feminine hips who can't mix his own highballs, holds production meetings in the hospital where his wife is giving birth, and has tantrums when MGM won't loan him Clark Gable, another reference to Selznick's real-life woes over casting Gone with the Wind. Told in a series of letters to her girlfriend and aunt, who was based on Schulman's favorite relative, her aunt Cia Weiss, journal entries, Western Union telegrams, and studio production memos, I Lost My Girlish Laughter fuses the perspective of the spunky American girl next door with the insider gossip of Luella Parsons and Sheila Graham. In the process, Madge gleefully punctures every golden PR myth about Hollywood in circulation. Readers familiar with the so-called greats of the Hollywood novel genre, from Nathaniel West's The Day of the Locust, 1939, to Raymond Chandler's The Little Sister, 1949, will feel like they're in new territory with the heroine of I Lost My Girlish Laughter. Her free-spirited first-person narration is reminiscent of the best of P.G. Wodehouse's stories, but there's also something of Edna Ferber's popular working woman heroine, Emma McChesney, in Madge Lawrence's down-to-earth charm. And though plenty of Hollywood fairy tales dealt and continue to deal in feminine heartache and betrayal, there's no time for tears or melodrama in this story, as the novel sets up its gags like the best of Leo McCarey's and Frank Capra's screwball comedies. But comparisons and context go only so far. I Lost My Girlish Laughter has a style, pace, and content all its own. Industry bigwigs would later have ulcers just wondering if they were parodied in the text. But Schulman and her co-writer had just as much fun sending up overrated foreign stars, such as Marlene Dietrich and Coconut Grove snobs like Paulette Goddard. Schulman's hero, the dashing agent Leland Hayward, recognizably named Hayworth Lord in the novel, royally screws Brand over in a contract hire, getting $1,500 a week for an unknown Broadway actor. At the time, $300 would have been the going rate. Friend Kay Brown was renamed Frances Smith, and as New York story editor, responds to her boss's frantic and illiterate memos with bland efficiency. Readers can view some of Selznick's memos, edited for content by Schulman and other studio secretaries, in Rudy Belmer's classic Memo from David O. Selznick, 1972. Another humorous touch was giving a rival MGM producer, Blank, for a surname, presumably because in real life, Selznick called this rival every imaginable foul word in private. Columnist Luella Parsons became Stella Carsons. Or, according to Brand's new high-toned, non-acting foreign star, Sarya Tarn, a version of Dietrich rather than of Samuel Goldwyn's Ukrainian failure, Anna Sten, that fat peasant. A smart-mouthed, if occasionally charming, publicity agent, Jim Palmer, was the cover for Schulman's new husband, Ring, who had joined the Selznick Empire in 1935 and was immediately smitten, as he wrote to his mother, by this mad Jewish girl in the office. Schulman would dedicate the book to him as J.P., Jim Palmer, in order to protect his anonymity. It's been said again and again by historians and journalists that Hollywood, during its big bad studio days, was strictly a man's world, where women were just decoration for casting couches, or secretaries getting the great men coffee, or highballs. In this novel, the truth is far more interesting. Sidney Brand may think he runs his studio, but women are working everywhere in Madge's Hollywood. The first place she lives in Hollywood is a women's dorm for Hollywood employees, a fictionalized Hollywood studio club. While many are extra girls on the break for the big chance, frighteningly young for the most part and devastatingly pretty, she notes that there are also an odd sprinkling of stenographers, script girls, assistant cutters, designers, a librarian or two, and one honest-to-goodness writer who has actually had her name on screen credits, but is very Scotch in makeup and is saving her money against a rainy day. The novel's penny-pinching writer is particularly apt, given that writers were struggling to secure union recognition and that it was well known that the average Hollywood writer made less than a secretary during the 1930s, and this includes Shore and Lardner. So does this mean I Lost My Girlish Laughter offers a rare feminist view of the film business way back in 1938? The opening pages reveal a surprisingly frank perspective. Although, as Madge admits in one letter to her girlfriend back in New York, I still have something in me of the old guard feminists who broke out in bloomers and smashed windows, she keeps her subversiveness to herself and a few trusted girlfriends. Sidney Brand may claim he wants to know the female angle, but as readers soon discover, that respect and commitment to equality is unreliable at best, for I Lost My Girlish Laughter goes on to parody the studio's devotion to female audiences. Though Brand changes the name of his next big film project from Sinners in Asylum, an adaptation of a recent New York play by a writer who vehemently and repeatedly denies being a communist, to great comic effect, to Lady in a Cage, Sarya Tarn's failure to win over audiences at a disastrous preview precipitates yet another change. The producer quickly renames it That Gentleman from the South and recuts the footage to emphasize Tarn's unknown male co-star. The incident was loosely based on Schulman and Lardner's terrible experiences with Marlene Dietrich during the production of The Garden of Allah, 1936. Demanding divas often spelled financial catastrophe for film companies. As Lardner fumed at the time, this whole picture has been a frightful mess from the beginning. A lower, more underhanded woman never existed than Marlene Dietrich. She has a pernicious influence on the morale of the whole organization. but the novel's chaotic production history for Sinners in Asylum, / Lady in a Cage, / That Gentleman from the South, also generates wider questions about Selznick's intent in making a film such as Gone with the Wind. Was it intended and marketed as a women's picture because it focuses on protagonist Scarlett O'Hara's experience, or because the gorgeous Mr. Gable plays Rhett Butler? Schulman knew the score. The studio producers understood that sexy male stars were even more important than strong female content in attracting female filmgoers. Madge is equally skeptical about women's own lack of solidarity in Hollywood's competitive marketplace. The film business may have offered women the best chance of earning professional respect and a decent wage in Depression-era America, but all women certainly didn't treat one another equally. In I Lost My Girlish Laughter, actresses, unless they are in supporting roles or are bit players, are self-obsessed snobs and won't talk to lowly secretaries like Madge. Sarya Tarn is hired for Brand's next picture after they meet while he's at a conference in Palm Springs. When Madge comes to work on her first day, she finds that she has displaced another secretary, likely based on workplace rival Marcella Bennett Robwin, who allegedly slept with Brand in hopes of a promotion. Women in Brand's organization are sometimes hired for their college educations, but just as often use the casting couch to get ahead. This certainly isn't Madge's way, but it's a strategy that works for some. It's to Madge's credit that, though she loses her girlish laughter, she doesn't become a total Hollywood cynic. In the end, she keeps both her feminism and her sense of humor. She pities the other secretary, banks rejected Christmas negligees intended for Mrs. Brand, a swipe at the industry's efforts to mask its Jewish heritage, admires the self-serving verve of a young supporting actress, and watches the downfall of Ms. Tarn with equanimity. If she has to stage a riot at a movie theater in order to prevent film critics from seeing Lady in a Cage, or fantasizes newspaper headlines about attacking her boss when he won't give her a lunch break, or is asked about the female angle in script meetings by clueless male writers, well, it's all in a day's work. And Madge's work days are sometimes 16-plus hours. Writing I Lost My Girlish Laughter was a risky venture. Brand was so recognizably Selznick, right down to the producer's Southern film production and crisis over getting MGM to loan Gable, and Selznick was MGM co-founder Louis B. Mayer's son-in-law. Going after Selznick was tantamount to going after MGM, Hollywood's richest, glitziest studio. But there was no way of telling whether the book's popularity and box office potential would mitigate its controversy. Other studio heads might gleefully option the material to the detriment of a rival, or they might close ranks and blackball it. If the press got wind of Shore's involvement in the novel, her Hollywood career would be truly over. The stakes were higher for Schulman. Although by the time the manuscript was finished, she had quit her job with Selznick, become Silvia Lardner, and was expecting her first child, she still had hopes of going back to work as a screenwriter. If she used her own name in publishing I Lost My Girlish Laughter, she would, as the saying goes, never have lunch in that town again. Her husband's new career as a writer would also be at stake. Admittedly, there were other possibilities. The novel could be so popular that she would make more money than they could spend, reboot her career as a screenwriter like her husband, or simply take a leaf out of her famous father-in-law's book, Ring Lardner Sr., and become the next great American humorist. Schulman duly concocted the pen name Jane Allen with Shore. But all her life, Schulman had been a fun-loving risk-taker. After all, once upon a time, she came out to Hollywood just like Madge, without knowing a soul. On a certain level, she didn't care if the press discovered her identity. When the book neared completion, they quietly contacted Margaret Mitchell's agent, Annie Laurie Williams, whom Schulman had met during Selznick's negotiations for Gone with the Wind. Williams recognized that she had the publishing sensation of 1938 in her hands and negotiated serialization with popular magazine Cosmopolitan before Random House printed the novel in the spring of 1938. When Schulman collected her $1,125 serialization check and the advance on the novel, about $20,000 in today's currency, Lardner acknowledged she shows signs of becoming the leading breadwinner in our menage. Her original idea paid off. New York critics raved that the book had a laugh on every page and that Madge's comments on the industry were masterpieces in humor and irony. Margaret Mitchell loved the book so much that she read it twice. But, as she confided to friend Susan Myrick, technical advisor on Selznick's adaptation of Gone with the Wind, she got a great deal more out of it from her second reading. Myrick had sent Mitchell a letter describing a chaotic GWTW script meeting involving Ben Hecht and John Van Druten. The situation was identical to one in I Lost My Girlish Laughter, and sent her into gales of laughter. The national press gleefully pointed out the satirical portrait of Selznick, drew unflattering comparisons between Sarya Tarn and the latest haughty foreign import to Hollywood, Hedy Lamarr, and made guesses about the identities of the other cast members. No other Hollywood novel had ever been quite so defiantly transparent about naming names. The buzz increased when journalists broke Schulman's cover and identified her as the author. Curiously, Jane Shore's name did not appear in these articles, perhaps because her authorial contribution was superficial compared to Schulman's, or perhaps because Shore still hoped to revive her Hollywood career once the film rights were secured, and believed anonymity would eventually work in her favor. The novel generated still more headlines when Orson Welles, already known for sensation-making stunts like the notorious October 1938 War of the Worlds broadcast, bought the radio rights. Much to Selznick's chagrin, Welles's Campbell Playhouse adaptation aired on CBS in January 1939, devilishly timed to coincide with principal photography on Gone with the Wind. In addition to Welles's own slick portrayal of the self-obsessed brand, audiences were teased with a purported interview with the book's author, Jane Allen. In his version, however, neither Madge nor her pseudonymous creators were the stars of the show. The radio adaptation replaced Madge as first-person narrator, played by Ilka Chase, with Brand. In Welles's view, male geniuses were more important than lowly secretaries. Movie-minded columnists were divided over actresses Joan Blondell or Jean Arthur in the lead role. Both had played versions of the plucky secretary on screen in the 1930s. But sadly, a film version never materialized, thanks in part to Selznick's pull with his father-in-law. And as Schulman put it in a letter to her mother-in-law, Ellis Lardner, a great reluctance on the part of producers here to buy a property blasting one of the boys. At one point early on, it had looked as though MGM would buy it, but very likely to prevent other studios from making it. Schulman went on to reveal that the story editor at MGM, very likely Lily Messenger, formerly at RKO, has threatened to wring my neck and is swearing by all the stars that Metro will buy the book over her dead body. So much for female solidarity. When the Hollywood offers failed to materialize, Schulman and her husband pursued the idea of co-writing a Broadway adaptation. Producer Jed Harris had expressed interest. Private letters in the Lardner family indicate that Shore balked at developing the stage version, and relations soured between the two writers. Any idea of a future partnership likely broke down when Schulman discovered Shore had only put her own name down as author in the novel's U.S. copyright filing following the book's publication in May 1938. Shore would continue to use the Jane Allen pseudonym when she sold A Girl's Best Friend is Wall Street to Cosmopolitan and secured the film deal with Columbia Pictures in 1940. But if the studio thought it was buying material from Schulman, they were wrong. She Knew All the Answers, 1941, was no I Lost My Girlish Laughter. Nor was Thanks God, I'll Take It From Here, Shore's second Hollywood novel, co-written by Mae Livingstone, Faber, 1946, which, as another film historian has noted, was surprisingly lifeless and pedestrian, despite some tacked-on memos toward the end of the story, reminiscent of I Lost My Girlish Laughter's format. But Shore at least scored another film deal. RKO transformed her novel about a novelist's foray into the motion picture business into Without Reservations, 1946. The film was notable only for pairing Claudette Colbert and John Wayne. Schulman's royalty checks dwindled, but her husband had writing stints at Warner Brothers and RKO. Things were tough for the couple at first. Few were interested in buying the words of the husband of an infamous Hollywood turncoat like Silvia Schulman. For her part, Schulman tinkered with short stories and the dramatization of the novel with Lardner, but concentrated on raising her two children, Peter and Anne. She was not nostalgic about her Hollywood career. As she remarked, "For years I put on a good show as a glorified hired hand." She preferred being in charge, even if the paychecks weren't as steady, and contemplated turning her skill with interior design into a paying career. Like her heroine Madge, she was petite, vivacious, and a survivor. "My mind's alive," she wrote to her mother-in-law, and as she put it simply, "I've started growing up." The family finances improved after MGM bought Lardner's script with Michael Kanin, Woman of the Year, 1942. But by then, the Schulman-Lardner marriage had already fallen apart. They divorced in 1945, and Schulman kept the children and the family home. Ironically, it was Irene and David Selznick who had initially urged her not to marry a non-Jewish man, stating that mixed marriages never worked. But the marriage didn't fail over religious reasons. Schulman was never a drinker and felt out of place and slightly skeptical among Lardner's hard-drinking, far-left-writing cronies. She and her former spouse remained friends, and she occasionally sent Lardner suggestions for stories to develop. She would go back to work as an interior designer and building contractor, establishing a successful business. She was the only woman on the masthead of the California-based Hale Company Builders during the 1950s, and loved building houses as much as she had loved writing her novel. She married again in 1955 and divorced in 1960, but kept working, slyly remarking to her first husband, "I seem to have the talent for being a self-supporting ex-wife." With the exception of Sylvia Jericho, wife of screenwriter Paul Jericho, and Annie Laurie Williams, her Hollywood friends had melted away long ago, and as time passed, she rarely discussed the old days. But Schulman's house was always full of books, and it must have been a bittersweet day when her kids were old enough to take the copy of I Lost My Girlish Laughter down from the shelf and read it for themselves. Schulman lived to see Peter and Anne become academics and publish their own books. She died of cancer in 1993. Looking back 80 years later, it's hard not to regret that I Lost My Girlish Laughter never made it to the big screen. The novel was published in an era when women still had some power in Hollywood, and as a testimony to the myths and realities of the female angle of the motion picture business during Hollywood's golden age. It is a shame Harry Cohn of Columbia Pictures, famous for courting controversy and hiring women filmmakers, didn't option it for his star Jean Arthur. She would have been superb as Madge. And if he hired Schulman to write the script with his one-time contract writer, Mary C. McCall Jr., and Dorothy Arzner, herself once a lowly Hollywood secretary, to direct, Columbia editor Viola Lawrence to cut, and Cohn's favorite executive, Virginia Van Upp, in charge of production, what could have been better? I Lost My Girlish Laughter is one of Hollywood's tragic, lost opportunities. Although the novel was reprinted in the 1950s in cheap paperback editions, with cover art exaggerating the lurid sexual escapades of the motion picture people, few literary critics took notice of what was inside the covers. Jane Allen and I Lost My Girlish Laughter vanished from cultural consciousness. Instead, Hollywood novels written by men, Nathaniel West, F. Scott Fitzgerald, The Last Tycoon, 1941, and Bud Schulberg, What Makes Sammy Run, 1941, became the canonical standards of the great Hollywood novel of this period. Madge Lawrence was completely upstaged by Fitzgerald's doomed mogul, Monroe Starr, based on MGM's boy genius, Irving Thalberg, and Schulberg's double-crossing screenwriter, Sammy Glick. These novels had cultural afterlives as films, The Day of the Locust, directed by John Schlesinger, 1975, The Last Tycoon, directed by Elia Kazan, 1976. Musicals, What Makes Sammy Run, 1964-65, 2006. And television series, What Makes Sammy Run, Philco Television Playhouse, 1949, NBC's Sunday Showcase, 1959, The Last Tycoon, Amazon Prime Video, 2016-17. Ironically, Selznick's A Star is Born has now been through four big-budget film versions, 1937, 1954, 1976, and 2018, a testimony in part to the enduringly popular view of Svengali-esque men molding a pretty face into a star. Perhaps now, with renewed interest in women in Hollywood, it's time to take notice of Madge Lawrence and what she had to say about the women who ran Hollywood behind the scenes so many years ago. J.E. Smythe. 1. I become a proletarian. Western Union, Hollywood, California, October 10th. Miss Agnes Lawrence, Kansas City, Missouri. Arrived safely. Stop. Staying at Girls Club. Stop. No, you will be delighted here. We are put to bed at 10 o'clock. Stop. Love, Madge. Girls Community Club, Hollywood, California, October 10th. Mr. Mark Freeman, National Studios, Hollywood, California. Dear Mr. Freeman, I am enclosing a letter of introduction which was given to me by Robert James. May I hope for an interview? Very truly yours, Madge Lawrence. October 20th. Liz, my pet. Your letter, dog-eared and worn, limped in from Kansas City and contacted me here. It served as a sweetly steadying anchor to the wind after 10 white-hot days of dizzying sunshine and abruptly chilled nights. I'm beginning to understand why the hot, hot tropics can do a white woman in. That interesting New York pallor of mine is a cute rosy red, except in places where a large, fat, brown freckle is parked. My hair has degenerated into a stringy frenzy, which no amount of brushing will curb. My svelte, not an ounce overweight size 12 chassis has developed suddenly bumptious symptoms that are definitely alarming, and altogether I don't seem to coordinate physically. There's nothing about me, in fact, that is familiar and reassuring any longer. And over all, that glaring, searing white sun. God, how I yearn for a clean, rain-swept afternoon around Washington Square. The club where I am stopping temporarily is merely a sop to Aunt Agnes's concern over her orphan niece. She knew someone who knew someone who met someone else who told her that all the nice girls stay here in this friendly, homey atmosphere, which is cheap, safe, and secure. At that, it's not a bad little hostelry, although it simply crawls with femmes. And wherever a mob of femmes gather, there is something depressing about the atmosphere. I wouldn't for the world admit that to a gentleman, because I still have something in me of the old guard feminists who broke out in bloomers and smashed windows. This little refuge, which was built on the largesse of movie money to make Hollywood safe for stray girls, is ever so Spanish, with white stucco walls and patios and cells glaringly clean and equally cheerless. There are 90 of us here, all career-bound in pictures but in the tadpole stage. The majority are extra girls on the break for the big chance, frighteningly young for the most part and devastatingly pretty. There is an odd sprinkling of stenographers, script girls.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.